Fighting in Aden ceased just over a year ago, but the situation is still tense, as evidenced by the frequent influxes of wounded at MSF's hospital there. The most recent was on the 29th of August.
When we heard the explosion, we activated the mass casualty plan in the hospital to be able to receive the wounded. It took us 10 minutes to prepare everything, get everything set up. After that, the wounded started to arrive. We received 46 dead and 60 wounded.
While many of the town's hospitals have reopened and more medical care is available than a year ago, their situation is far from being stable.
We received thousands of wounded last year. Most of the hospitals here have been crippled by the war and are unable to respond to all of the healthcare needs. And often, the hospitals in Aden, both public and private hospitals, struggle to get what they need in terms of supply. The health sector here in Aden is not in good shape.
Some patients admitted by the teams in Aden have been referred from Taiz, a town about 200 kilometers away where it's harder still to get medical care. MSF supports several of the town's hospitals, including the one in Atiaba.
Many of the roads leading to the hospital here are cut off or difficult to drive on. A lot of patients barely make it to the hospital. Several people have even died on the road trying to get here.
Atiaba is a district with 30,000 inhabitants on the outskirts of Taiz. But with so few medical facilities, 100,000 people depend on this one hospital. Since the summer, Maiduguri's health centres have been constantly full. In Maimusari, the teams provide outpatient consultations to around 3,000 women and children every week. Malaria, malnutrition and diarrhoea are among the main illnesses. Patients with diarrhoea are a warning sign for the teams to prepare for a potential cholera outbreak. In Gwange, there's an intensive therapeutic feeding centre providing care to children with severe malnutrition. Its 110 beds are occupied non-stop. Malnourished children treated with nasogastric tubes or therapeutic foods usually spend a week in the unit. The food crisis affecting the region's inhabitants is far from over, as the insecurity continues to prevent them from cultivating their fields. Some displaced people in Maiduguri, who have received no food aid whatsoever in the past 2 months, are getting angry. Ten million people live in Kinshasa, the capital of the Democratic Republic of Congo. To prevent the spread of the yellow fever epidemic that struck Central Africa at the beginning of the year, the authorities have launched a vaccination campaign. After vaccinating 350,000 people in Matadi, close to the Angolan border, MSF has now immunized 710,000 people living in the capital.
I queued for a long time because I knew that this outbreak had killed many people in Angola. I came here to protect my health, so I waited patiently to get this vaccine before going home.
Incurable, yellow fever kills 15 to 50% of people contracting its most severe form. 74 cases have been confirmed in the DRC and 16 of them have died. Vaccination and combating the mosquito carrying the virus are the most effective ways of avoiding further fatalities. Resistance to antibiotics is a global public health issue. But in countries with limited resources, where health systems are failing, where sanitation is poor, and where there are no regulations on the prescribing of antibiotics, it takes on alarming proportions. In economically developed countries, to find out which bacterium is responsible for an infection and the antibiotics required to treat it, all it takes is a few tests in a laboratory. These tests are available in countries capable of guaranteeing a reliable supply of water and electricity, a controlled temperature, and no dust or humidity. They also have the skilled personnel and the equipment and products needed to implement the tests. Also, many constraints in short supply or difficult to access in many of the countries where MSF operates. Without the means to accurately diagnose infections and no drug prescription regulations, for many years, doctors have been extensively prescribing broad-spectrum antibiotics effective against several bacteria at the same time. This has created antibiotic resistance, which makes it extremely hard to treat diseases such as meningitis, dysentery, pneumonia, and generalized blood infections. In response, MSF is currently developing a portable laboratory that will have all the features of a regular laboratory, but can be adapted to conditions in the settings where it works. It will have to comply with certain specifications. It must be tropicalized, meaning resistant to heat and moisture. Simple to use, so it can be operated by staff with just a few days' training. Hard wearing, compact, cheap, and easy to transport. The laboratory will enable better diagnosis and documenting of antibiotic resistances. It will be used primarily for newborns and children, particularly those with malnutrition or who are HIV positive, and war casualties. Set up in cooperation with public institutions and private partners, the mini lab project is expected to last several years. The first phase requires selecting the best suited innovations and testing them in the field, and then making a prototype of the portable laboratory that will be used to run them.
On avait un patient justement yézidi qui a été torturé par l'ISIS pendant un an et qui est devenu vraiment fou hein, à la suite de ça. C'est-à-dire fou, c'est-à-dire qu'en fait il s'est retiré de la vie psychiquement, il n'était plus capable de répondre, de participer à la vie quotidienne. Malgré ça, il a été emmené sur le chemin de l'exil par sa famille, hein, son frère, sa belle-sœur, son neveu, et c'est comme ça qu'il est arrivé en Grèce. Et on a essayé de l'aider, on lui a donné un traitement pour essayer de le sortir de cet état-là, mais à un moment, il a fait un épisode psychotique aigu. On a dû l'hospitaliser en hôpital grec, et malheureusement, l'hôpital grec, eh ben, il subit les problèmes financiers de ce pays. Ils sont totalement incapables d'accueillir un patient qui avait besoin d'un abri, il ne savait plus du tout ce qu'il faisait, il partait en courant, il se perdait, etc. Ce qui fait qu'on a dû faire un tour de rôle 24 heures sur 24 pour être présent auprès de lui parce que le staff était incapable de le retenir. Les portes n'étaient pas fermées, les infirmiers n'étaient pas en nombre suffisant, le psychiatre ne venait pas assez souvent et n'avait pas d'interprète pour lui parler. Donc on devait aussi fournir l'interprète à chaque fois qu'on voulait un entretien avec le psychiatre de l'hôpital. La nourriture n'était pas fournie, même les chaises pour les accompagnants, on a dû les louer, enfin c'était terrible. Et moi je me sens responsable, je suis partie, c'est pour ça que j'en parle, je suis partie, il est encore à l'hôpital dans ces conditions-là, avec une prise en charge tout à fait déplorable. Et ça je trouve ça le mot dommage pour quelqu'un qui en a tellement bavé. Le seul moyen qu'il trouvait de le retenir, c'était de l'attacher. Pour quelqu'un qui a dû être attaché pendant un an, c'est terrible. On a essayé d'expliquer ça, mais il n'avait pas d'autre moyen pour retenir quelqu'un contre son gré que de l'attacher.